So welcome back for the second installment of the Logic and Databases mini course. Yesterday we introduced the relational data model and relational calculus and relational algebra as the two query languages that Ted Kott proposed back in the late 60s, early 70s. And then we identified three fundamental problems in relational databases. The first is the query evaluation problem, which is given a query Q in the language that we have at hand, and the database D evaluate Q on D. If Q is a Boolean query, this is a decision problem. Otherwise, a problem with an output, a carry relation, if K is the arity of the query. The query containment problem, given two queries Q and Q prime, is one contained in the other. This is a version of logical implication, meaning are the answers of the first query on every database contained on the answers of the query on the second database. And the query equivalence problem, which means do the queries always give you the same answers on a database. And for the query evaluation problem, we had a finer classification of the notion by looking at three versions of this that we owe to Moshe Vardi from his 1982 paper. The combined complexity, if you have a database query language, the combined complexity of the language is the decision problem where both the sentence and the database instance are part of the input, and you ask whether or not the database satisfies the sentence. Out of this, by keeping one of the two parameters fixed, we get two families of decision problems. The data complexity is the family of decision problems where you have one for every sentence, and the problem is given a database, does the database satisfy the sentence? Again, a family of problems. If you do it the other way around, if you fix the database, you get the query complexity of the language, one for every database. And also we had the companion notions of what it means for data complexity and query complexity to be C complete for some complexity class, and this means that for every member of the family there in the class C, and there is at least one member in the family for which the problem is complete for the corresponding class. And the summary that we saw last time was, first of all, Kott's theorem that algebra and calculus have essentially the same expressive power with the qualification that we have to work with the active domain. The query equivalence problem and the query containment problem are undecidable. That was via Trachtenberg's theorem. The query evaluation problem is certainly decidable, and we have this ramification about its complexity. The data complexity is in logarithmic space, in particular it's in polynomial time. Combined complexity and query complexity are p-space complete. And this motivated the question that I asked towards the end of the lecture yesterday: can we find interesting sublanguages of relational calculus or relational algebra for which these two problems are easier? And the first answer tends out to be the language of conjunctive queries is certainly such a language. So a conjunctive query, again, is given by a first order formula, which is a bunch of existential quantifiers applied to a conjunction of atomic formulas. And we can view this equivalently as a projection of a selection of a Cartesian product in relational algebra, where the selection is a conjunction of equality atoms, or in SQL, that will be the translation, again, the where condition is a conjunction of equalities. This is all review from yesterday. That's pretty much where we finished. And in particular, natural joins will play a big role for us in this lecture and in subsequent lectures. A natural join is a conjunctive query with no existential quantified variables. And these are the examples that we saw from yesterday. So we now have the previous problems. I'm picking here two of the three, conjunctive query evaluation and conjunctive query containment. This is the query evaluation and query containment restricted to the language of conjunctive queries. And also we introduced towards the end of the lecture the notion of the homomorphism problem, which is given two databases, D and F, is there a homomorphism from the first to the second? And complexity-wise, it's very easy to see that the homomorphism problem is NP-complete. Easy reduction from tricolorability, a graph is tricolorable if and only if there is a homomorphism to the clique with three elements. So it's even NP-complete when we fixed one of the structures to be K3. And now we come to the first main result of today's lecture that I promised last time. And this is the Chandra-Merlin theorem from 1977, that although at the level of relational calculus, conjunctive query evaluation and query containment are very different problems, when you restrict them to conjunctive queries, they turn out to be the same problem. And in a precise sense, each of them turns out to be equivalent to the homomorphism problem. And what you get out of this is that both of these problems are NP-complete. So what is the link? How can we establish this link? We need to bring into the picture two other concepts. The one is the canonical conjunctive query, and the other is the canonical database instance. Before I give you the definitions, let me say what the idea is. A conjunctive query is a syntactic object, but we will take a look at it and see it as a database. Conversely, when we have a database, we will look at it and see in front of us a conjunctive query. For those of you who are familiar with mathematical logic, in effect, this is the passage from a relational structure to the existential positive diagram of the structure. So more formally, now we're going to go from the database to a conjunctive query. So suppose we're given a database with these relations. Then out of this, we extract a Boolean conjunctive query. The variables are just the elements of the active domain. And we have as many quantifiers as, existential quantifiers as the elements, one for each element. And then the atoms are just the facts of the database. And by fact, I mean the assertions that the tuple belongs to one of the relations. So from the database, we extract a conjunctive query. For example, suppose our database was a cycle of length 3, EAB, EBC, ECA. The query, the canonical conjunctive query, says there are three elements and they form a cycle. So we make the passage from the database to the canonical conjunctive query. And as a logic rule, it's given by this, as we discussed yesterday. Yes?
Don't we want to assert that the elements that are being quantified are not equal? Or
no, we don't. We expressly don't, because then we have to work with one-to-one homomorphisms.
Okay.
Hold on to this thought, because towards the end, this issue will come up, and you will see it complicates matters enormously if our queries have inequalities in them. But thanks for the question. Yeah. All right. So more examples here. If I have the clique with three elements, that's the canonical conjunctive query. It asserts there exist three elements, and we have all these symmetric edges present. So from the database, we pass to the canonical conjunctive query. But we can do also the reverse. And the reverse is, if one gives us a conjunctive query, we strip the existential quantifiers, and we look at a bunch of atoms. And now we view this as a database. Think of this as being the Herbrand universe, the Herbrand structure that you get from this very simple logic rule that you had here. So for instance, if this was our conjunctive query, the canonical instance consists of these three facts. In other words, the edge relation has these pairs. So there is this passage from the query to the database, and from the database to the query, and this is an idempotent up to isomorphism. Now, this is a trivial lemma, but I'm going to call it the magic lemma, just to give it a name. There is really nothing magic about it, except it's very useful. And it allows us to connect these ideas to homomorphisms. So this lemma says that if you have a Boolean conjunctive query and some database instance, then the assertion that the database instance satisfies the query is equivalent to the existence of a homomorphism from the canonical database of the query to the database instance you are given. I'm going to put it here on the board because I'm going to refer to it in the proof of the Chandra-Merling theorem. So we have a conjunctive query, Q, a conjunctive query Q, and a Boolean. And the database F. And then we are saying that the following are equivalent. One, the database satisfies the query. Two, there is a homomorphism. H, from the canonical database of the query to F. This is really a trivial lemma. It boils down to the fact that the semantics of first order logic, the Tarskian semantics for first order logic for positive sentences are essentially asserting the existence of a homomorphism. If you want a more formal proof, here it is. Let this be the query. Exist x1, xm, phi. This is a conjunction of atoms. If the database satisfies the query, then the semantics of first order logic tells us that there are elements, so that when we replace the variables by the elements, they are true on the database. This function then, that gives values to the database to every variable, is a homomorphism from the canonical conjunctive query to the database. Vice versa, if we had such a homomorphism, that's an assignment of values to the variables that satisfies the query. So it's just the semantics of first order logic in this case amount to the existence of a homomorphism. This, however, turns out to be very useful because now we can prove the Chandra-Merlin homomorphism theorem, which tells us the following. If I have two Boolean conjunctive queries, then the following three statements are equivalent. One is that Q is contained in Q prime, meaning the answers on every database D, the answers of Q and D are contained in the answers of Q prime of D, or since these are Boolean, it means that if a database satisfies Q, then it satisfies Q prime. Second, there is a homomorphism from the canonical database of the bigger query to the canonical database of the smaller query. And third, the canonical database of Q satisfies Q prime. Just to appreciate this, look at the first and the third. The first statement is a statement about all databases. It says that on every database F, if F satisfies Q, it satisfies Q prime. The third statement says that to check this, it suffices to check that Q prime is satisfied by a very special database, namely the canonical database associated with the query Q. And as you see, the link between the two is going to be the homomorphism, the existence of a homomorphism from the canonical database of Q prime to the canonical database of Q. This has a dual form that for instances D and D prime, the following are equivalent. There is a homomorphism from D to D prime. This is equivalent to D prime satisfying the canonical conjunctive query of Q. And it's equivalent to Q of D prime being contained in Q of D. I will just do the one version, and then you can derive the other by duality. I should say there is a version of this for Boolean queries of positivity. I will suppress this. I will just focus on the Boolean version. So now I have set up things that hopefully in one slide I can prove this theorem. We are going to use the magic lemma. And we're going to go round robin. 1 implies 2, 2 implies 3, 3 implies 1. And as a quiz, how many times do you think we're going to use the magic lemma? 1, 2, 3. Actually, you're going to use it 5 times. Okay. All right. So let's see how it's this. So we want to prove that 1 implies 2. Well, assume that Q is contained in Q prime. But you see, the canonical conjunctive query of Q certainly satisfies Q. This is just by the definition. Therefore, by the containment, we have that D, the canonical database of Q, satisfies Q prime. Now we go to the magic lemma with Q being Q prime and F being D of Q. By the magic lemma, direction 1 implies 2, tells us that there is a homomorphism from dq prime to dq. So use the magic lemma once. 2 implies 3 is the other direction of the magic lemma. If there is such a homomorphism from dq prime to dq, then by the direction 2 implies 1 of the magic lemma, we get that dq satisfies q prime. So now we go to what is perhaps the most interesting direction, that 3 implies 1, because we only know that one database satisfies q prime. And out of this, we want to infer that every database that satisfies q satisfies q prime. So here it is. Assume that dq satisfies q prime. We apply the magic lemma a third time. And that gives us a homomorphism h from dq prime to dq. So put it on the stack. We have obtained, from the hypothesis, a homomorphism from dq prime to dq using the magic lemma. Our goal now is to show that if f satisfies q, then f satisfies q prime. So suppose that f satisfies q. Then by the magic lemma, that's the fourth application, there is a homomorphism h from dq to f. We have a homomorphism from dq to f. But look, we have another homomorphism from dq prime to dq. And the composition of 2 homomorphisms is a homomorphism. So now we have a homomorphism from dq to f prime. Now we apply the magic lemma one more time, and we have that f satisfies q prime. So these are the 5 uses of the magic lemma, which again, I said there is nothing magic about it, just the semantics of first order logic. So this is a simple result, but it was discovered by people in databases, stated in this form. And now we can reap the consequences. But before doing this, let me show you a couple of applications. These 2 queries seem to be very different. The first says there is an undirected edge. The other says there is an undirected cycle of length 4. But actually, you have homomorphisms going both ways. And from this, you can infer that these 2 queries are equivalent, which may not be so easy to see. Of course, what's going on is that both these graphs are 2 colorable, right? So that's the other reason that these queries are equivalent. Here is another example. Let's revisit 3 colorability from the database point of view. We know that the graph is 3 colorable if and only if there is a homomorphism from G to K3. From the homomorphism theorem of Chandra and Merlin, this tells us that this is equivalent to a query evaluation problem. Namely, K3 satisfies Q of G, and is equivalent to a query containment problem, conjunctive query containment problem. So in principle, you could use DB2 to solve 3 colorability. It's not a good idea. It's going to do very poorly, because DB2 or Oracle SQL Server of Microsoft are geared towards large databases and small queries. And here we have exactly the opposite situation. We have a very tiny database and a huge query, the arbitrary graph that comes into the picture. We get immediately a whole bunch of corollaries here. We get that the following problems are NP complete, query containment and query evaluation. Membership in NP follows from the homomorphism theorem. Q is contained in Q prime if there is a homomorphism. And that's a polynomial guess in the size of the queries, because the canonical databases have the same size as the queries. And NP hardness, of course, follows from 3 colorability. So we have a dramatic drop from undecidability and NP space completeness for query containment and query evaluation at the level of relational calculus down to NP completeness for these 2 problems at the level of conjunctive queries. And it's also easy to see that the query equivalence problem also an NP complete. The query equivalence problems amounts to checking that the canonical databases are homomorphically equivalent. It is in NP, and it's NP complete because given a graph containing a triangle, is it 3 colorable? That's easily seen to be NP complete. And then if you have a graph that contains a triangle, then the graph is 3 colorable if and only if it is the conjunctive query of H is, the canonical conjunctive query of H is equivalent to the canonical conjunctive query of Q3. So these are all corollaries that you get out of this one homomorphism theorem. And this is the picture. I'll be expanding on this picture as I'll be adding bigger classes of queries. in some sense, this not only summarizes the results we have presented so far, but also shows an interesting trade-off. Here we have a lot of expressive power, all of first-order logic, but we hit undecidability at query equivalence and query containment, and we hit also p-space completeness in both combined complexity and query complexity of the query evaluation problem. On the other hand, if we set our horizons lower and we work with conjunctive queries, then all these three problems, evaluation, query equivalence, and query containment, become NP-complete. So that's, in some sense, the trade-off between giving up on expressive power but gaining better computational behavior. But now you see this is really the beginning of a further investigation, at least that's what happened in the late 70s, early 80s, because people asked, okay, now we know that the conjunctive queries have better behavior than the full calculus, the full algebra. Let's extend them a little bit and see how far we can go. There are two extensions that come to mind. If you think about it, as we saw before, conjunctive queries form the sublanguage of relational algebra obtained by using Cartesian product, projection, and selection with equality conditions. Conspicuously absent from these operations is union. So the first question would be, what if you also had union? Remember, relational algebra has these three operations, plus union, plus difference, right? Okay. So what happens if we add union? So a union of conjunctive queries is basically a disjunction of the formulas that define conjunctive queries. So Q1 union Q2 union Q, finite union, where each QI is a conjunctive query. So you want to say there is a path of length 2 or there is a path of length 5. I mean, questions like this. Now, closely related to conjunctive queries are the monotone queries. The monotone queries are the queries expressible by an algebra expression that uses only join, Cartesian product, projection, and selection with equality conditions. It takes a minute to realize that the union of conjunctive queries is a normal form for monotone queries, because basically, if you have a product of sums, you can write it as a sum of products in this algebra. Clearly, every union of conjunctive queries is a monotone query. But every monotone query is equivalent to a union of conjunctive queries, but the union may have, in general, exponentially many disjuncts. That's the price of expanding when we multiply polynomials. And monotone queries at the level of logic are precisely the queries expressible by relational calculus expression using conjunction, disjunction, and existential quantification. So no form of negation, not even inequalities. Let's make it concrete. This is a union of conjunctive queries that expresses that we have either a path of length 1 or a path of length 2. This is a monotone query. I have these four relations, and I take the relational join. Remember, the relational join is a projection of a selection of equijoins, Cartesian product. And if I spell it out, we can multiply, we get really a conjunctive query, but now we have a bigger expression. So from the expressive power point of view, monotone queries are the same as unions of conjunctive queries, but the syntax of monotone queries can be more compact. And we will see we'll pay a price for this. Here is a very nice result, very simple result, once we have the homomorphism theorem. This is from a very basic paper by Saigiv and Yannakakis in 1981. That explored these problems, the containment problem, for monotone queries and for unions of conjunctive queries. This gives a necessary and sufficient condition for a union of conjunctive queries to be contained in another union of conjunctive queries. And you should think of this as saying that this happens in the most blatant, if it's an if and only if statement that happens in the most blatant way. What is the most blatant way? The most blatant way for this union to be contained in that union is if every member of the union of the first is contained in some of the second, right? This is the most obvious way. This is certainly a sufficient condition. The result tells you that this is the only way it can happen. that if you have containment, then necessarily it must be the case that for every conjunctive query on the left, there is a conjunctive query on the right, so that you have containment of the query of the left in the query on the right. And this is not true if you have, let's say, unions of arbitrary relational algebra expressions. This is far from true. It's easy to construct counterexamples. But at this level, it's true. And the proof is fits again in the page. We're going to use the homomorphism theorem. And here is how we're going to use it. So obviously, the direction 2 implies 1 is trivial. So I'm going to argue about the direction 1 implies 2. So here is the hypothesis. Q1 union Q2 union Qm is contained Q1 prime dot dot union Qn prime. We want to prove that every query on the left is contained in some query on the right. Let's take one of the queries on the left. Let's say you take Qi. The canonical database of the query Qi that we saw before certainly satisfies the query. We have discussed this. Therefore, by containment, the canonical database of Qi satisfies this union. Therefore, by the semantics of first order logic, there must be some member of the union that dQi satisfies Qj prime. But then by the homomorphism theorem, we have that Qi is contained in Qj prime. So it's a very nice application of the homomorphism theorem. The other direction is obvious, but this has computational consequences. Because what this gives us immediately is that the query containment problem for unions of conjunctive queries is NP-complete, is certainly NP-hard. That's already we know because it's true for conjunctive queries. But we can make a big guess, but still a polynomial size guess, namely, to test that one union is contained in the other, we guess pairs of queries on, for every query on the left, we get a pair of a query on the right in the homomorphism and verify that it's a homomorphism from the canonical database of the one to the canonical database of the other. And all this whole thing is a polynomial guess. So that's the computational content of the Sagiv-Yannakakis theorem, is that it's an NP algorithm for testing for query containment for unions of conjunctive queries. It's easy to see that the query evaluation problem for unions of conjunctive queries is NP-complete. And I leave this as an exercise. But now with this, we can add to our picture. And the picture is that when we go to unions of conjunctive queries, we don't pay any price over what we had for conjunctive queries. So adding union is no problem. We're still staying in the same complexity bounds as was the case for conjunctive queries. Now you may wonder what happened to the monotone queries. Here we pay a price. And the price we pay is basically a syntax complexity trade-off. They have the same expressive power, but because the monotone queries, if they are written as union of conjunctive queries, are much more succinct, it turns out, and I won't go over the proof of this, that the containment problem for monotone queries is pi to p complete. This is the second level of the polynomial hierarchy, so it's above NP and above co-NP. If you are not familiar with this, the canonical, the prototypical complete problem is quantified Boolean formulas with two alternations of quantifiers starting with universal. So universal existential followed by propositional logic. This is a complete problem for this class for pi to p. So now, and also query containment. So for monotone queries, the query evaluation stays NP-complete, but we pay a price at the level of query equivalence and query containment, even though they have the same expressive power. I mean, there are many examples in logic where this type of trade-off appears. We have the same expressive power, but the translation blows up the complexity in one of the accompanying algorithmic problems. So what else can I tell you? Let's try some other variations of this. And this goes back to Kusha's question. Then people started saying, what if I put a little bit of negation? And let's take the most innocent-looking form of negation. Let's take inequalities. And of course, we can say also less than and less than or equal if the variables in that attribute happen to be over an ordered set. As an example, I can write things like this. Okay. I can have constants there. Let's say I want to fly from San Francisco to Athens but avoid New York and London, right? I can write via with at most two stops. So I can write a query like that. But to say that I avoid this place or that place, I want to fly with certainly two different stops than that where I would use inequalities. So now we have two results there. And again, I won't give the proof. I'm just showing you the results. Tony Klug, who was a brilliant computer scientist who died very, very young in an accident, in 1988, showed that the query containment problem for conjunctive queries with inequalities is in pi 2p. And van der Meijden in 1992 proved that it's pi 2p complete. Let me just say a few words about the membership in pi 2p. When you have inequalities, even just not equal, you no longer have a single canonical database. You have to deal with equality types. So you have to consider a whole bunch of exponentially many databases that represent the complete equality types that extend the partial equality type that the query has. And then containment amounts to containment in each of these exponentially many databases. So this is really what's going on. And that's the proof that this is in pi2p. So you have to say that for every such canonical complete database with inequality types, there is a homomorphism. That's the membership in pi2p. And this can be completed. The hardness, this was open, the hardness, and van der Meijden in a Potts 1992 paper provided the lower bound. The query evaluation problem stays NP complete. So now we have a full picture of what happens. Monotone queries and conjunctive queries with inequalities have essentially the same behavior with respect to these problems. And you see also the jump, though, for equivalence and containment when you go from the unions either to the monotone with a more equal expressive power, more compact syntax, or strictly higher expressive power. So this is pretty much the story of trying to see how far you can go with unions of conjunctive queries, with extensions of conjunctive queries. And I want now to switch gears and for the remaining of the time, try to connect to some of the things that Anu said and introduce another language that goes in some sense beyond relational calculus. And this goes back to the fact that in spite of the fact that algebra and calculus can express a whole bunch of interesting queries, natural join, unions of conjunctive queries, queries with universal quantifiers, they cannot express recursive queries. And at some point, database theorists introduce a language called datalog. How many people are familiar with datalog? Not very many. Okay. Apologies to those who know datalog probably more than I do, but I need to introduce it in a self-contained way. So that's a declarative query language that augments the language of conjunctive queries with a recursion mechanism. So I will give you the precise definition. The high-level description is that this is the marriage of conjunctive queries with recursion. And we saw this result. In the database world, is known as the Echo-Ullmann theorem. In a paper they published in 1979 in the most prestigious conference on programming languages, POPL, Principles of Programming Languages. And this is 1979. This is, you know, less than about a decade after Codd's relational model. SQL was just around. And they pointed out that no relational algebra expression defines the transitive closure of a given binary relation. And so, you know, SQL is not a Turing complete language in that form. It cannot express transitive closure. But as we saw from Anuze's nice lectures yesterday and today, this was in some sense already known to Frise back in 1954, right? And the reason is that the relational calculus first order logic. First order logic can express only local properties. So here is again the example of the one cycle and the two cycles. So we cannot express connectivity in first order logic. So Echo and Ullmann published this paper, they were unaware of the work in finite model theory. They just rediscovered the technique of games, essentially. And then they raised the question that something has to be done about this. We need to do something to fix this apparent deficiency in the expressive language, or in the expressive power of a language like Datalog. So what can, in language like relational calculus, what can be done to overcome these limitations? There was a quick and dirty solution that came immediately. This is embedded relational calculus. So you allow SQL commands inside the conventional programming language like C or Java. That certainly solves the problem. I mean, you can now do transitive closure, right? By matrix multiplication or what have you. But that goes completely against the spirit of what Code had, because Code wanted to do programming at a high level. He wanted to separate the declarativeness of programming from the actual implementation, worrying about arrays and pointers, right? So there was another question, another solution, which was to augment relational calculus with a high-level declarative mechanism for expressing transitive closure and other such recursive queries. And from the conceptual point of view of what people try to do with database language design, this was a superior solution because it maintains this high-level declarative character. And that brings us to what I said before, language Datalog. That's a term coined by Dave Meyer, one of Ullman's students. And it's the marriage of conjunctive queries plus recursion. It was introduced by Chandra and Harel in 1982. And was beaten to death by the database theory community until 1995. By this, I mean hundreds of research papers, numerous dissertations. And then in 1995, people kind of gave up on Datalog. It was not getting traction. And thought it was one of these languages that theoreticians looked and then they abandoned. But in the last 8 or 10 years, Datalog has made a great comeback. It has been used, starting with a work that was here, done here at Berkeley by Joe Hellerstein and his students, as a language for specifying network protocols. It has been used by people in Microsoft in designing access control languages for privacy applications. And there is a very successful company, LogicBlocks. Do we have anyone from LogicBlocks today here? No, yesterday we had 3 people. This is a company that it's distributed, but has a branch office here at Berkeley. And they use Datalog, they have built a Datalog engine for business analytics. And they have hired a lot of logicians and database theorists too. So there are all these applications, and I want to say a few words, spend the rest of the time discussing Datalog. And finally, in 1999, SQL and subsequent versions of the SQL standard provide support for a fragment of Datalog called linear Datalog. And I hope I'll get to at least tell you what linear Datalog is. What is a Datalog program? Well, a Datalog program is really a finite set of rules where each rule has exactly the syntax of a conjunctive query. But there is a difference. When we had the conjunctive query written as a rule, we had the head of the rule, and that was a new symbol that did not appear on the right. Here we are trying to marry conjunctive queries with recursion, so we may have the name of a relation appear on the left and the right. And the relation names that appear both on the left and the right, not on the same rule, in some rule, right? These are called the recursive predicates. Everything else is called, is the given database predicates, and a name for them is extensional database predicates. And the idea is you are given a database, and these are the predicates that occur on the right but not on the left. You have the rules, and the rules give a recursive specification of the intentional predicates, the recursive predicates, the ones that appear both on the left and the right. So that was the idea. And here is a example that no one can avoid, a Datalog program for transitive closure. So you say, what does it take to have a path from X to Y? Well, there is one possibility that there is an edge, or So think of the second rule as being an or there is an odd from which there is an edge from x to z and then a path from z to y. So here we have one extensional predicate, that's the given, that's the graph that's given. T is the intentional or recursive predicate because it appears on both the left and the right. And the idea is that this gives us a recursive specification of the transitive closure. Here is another data log program also for the transitive closure, except now this embodies the divide and conquer algorithm, that there is a path if there is an edge, or there is a path if there is a z, and there is a path from x to z, and a path from z to y. So the semantics are the same. They both give you a transitive closure. But as we will see, at the operational level, they have different behavior that we will uncover in a little bit. Questions? Okay. Here is a data log program for paths of odd and even length. And the idea is that we can allow multiple intentional or recursive predicates. So this is an example of mutual recursion expressed in data log. Now, what is the precise semantics of data log? If Anous had talked about least fixed point logic, it would be a one-liner. But Anous told me he's not going to talk until lecture 4. So you can view this as a gentle introduction to least fixed point logic. So if you know what least fixed point logic is, then the answer is data log coincides with existential positive least fixed point logic. And what this means is that if I give you a data log program like this, you can extract an existential positive sentence in the following way. We have disjunctions. Every rule gives rise to a disjunct. And you just write down from the rule, you write the corresponding query. Now you get a first order formula, which is positive, both in T and in all the other predicates. And then the semantics of the data log program is the least fixed point of this formula, which is guaranteed to exist by monotonicity. So that's the one-liner. And but since we don't have the benefit of having seen the semantics of least fixed point logic, I'm going to give you, but quickly though, a long and self-contained answer, perhaps in a slightly different way than it's usually done, because I want to do it through relational algebra. So the data log programs can be given two different types of semantics. One is declarative or denotational semantics. As the least fixed points of monotone operators or smaller solutions of recursive specifications, this is what I want to talk about. And then procedural semantics as an iterative process for computing the meaning of a data log program. And the main result, which is also a special case of the result about least fixed point logic, is that the two formalisms coincide with each other. So every data log program can be viewed as a recursive specification of its intentional or of its recursive predicates. I explained this before. When you do this, not as a formula, but at the level of relational algebra, and I write this in relational algebra, I get a recursive equation in relational algebra. This says that T is equal to E union, the projection along 1 and 4 of the selection 2, 3, T with T. So we want to give meaning to solutions of these such recursive equations. And if we have this program that had two recursive predicates, then instead of getting one recursive equation, we get a system of equations. So we want to give meaning to these semantics of recursive equations in relation of relational algebra. Now the problem is that they don't have a unique solution. If they had a unique solution, which is the case when we write definitions of primitive recursion, we are done. In general, they have multiple solutions. So which one should we select? Well, the approach here is that small is beautiful, and small is beautiful means that, fortunately, among the various solutions, there is the smallest one. And we get this one, and we declare it to be the semantics. So every recursive equation arising from a data log program has a smallest solution. In particular, the smallest solution of this one, which arises from the data log program for transitive closure, this data log program is the smallest solution is the transitive closure. And this is a special case of the so-called Knaster-Tarski theorem for smaller solutions of recursive equations arising from monotone operators. What was important here is that when you write these specifications, these equations, you have only monotone relational algebra operations. We don't have difference, right? And that's the declarative part. The procedural part is that we have a computational procedure for doing the following. We take the bottom-up evaluation. We take the program. We set all recursive predicates to the empty set. And then we apply all the rules in parallel. We evaluate every right-hand side with the recursive predicates being empty. These are conjunctive queries. We do conjunctive query evaluation. We get new values. We plug them in. We repeat. We plug them in. We repeat until the process produces no new tuples in the recursive predicates. Then we declare that this is the answer. This is the semantics to the program. When we do it concretely, for this program, the iterations, the nth level of the iteration tells us that there is a path of length at most n from A to B. So when we take the union of all these, we get the transitive closure. Notice here the nth iteration gave us the path of length at most n. If we do the alternative program for transitive closure, the divide and conquer, we get the same meaning at the end. But somehow, this converges faster because at the nth iteration, we get all pairs of points connected via a path of length at most 2 to the n. So that's the benefit of the divide and conquer. And I'll skip this one. And then the theorem that connects the declarative with the procedural is that the bottom-up evaluation of the procedural semantics terminates within a number of steps. And this number of steps is bounded by a polynomial in the size of a database. And then the declarative semantics coincides with the procedural semantics. So this tells two things. One, that this bottom evaluation is guaranteed to terminate. In fact, fast, bounded by a polynomial in the size of a database, the degree of the polynomial depends on the program. And when you terminate, what you get is the least fixed point that you wanted of the recursive specification. So we're going to do both at once. And this is basically induction and monotonicity. So using the monotonicity of the operators, basically the monotonicity of units of conjunctive queries, you prove that as you do this bottom-up evaluation at every level, you are guaranteed to have containment of the previous level to the next. Therefore, we have an increasing sequence of relations. But you see, each of these relations is a carry relation. I'm doing this for a data log program with a single recursive predicate of RETK. These are all subsets of the active domain of the database to the K, where K is the RET of the recursive predicate. Therefore, this can't keep going more than the cardinality of the active domain to the K. It has to stabilize. When it stabilizes, we have found a solution to the recursive equation. And then we prove that this is the smallest solution, because if we take another solution using, again, monotonicity, we prove by induction that all the stages are contained in this. So this achieves both these goals, the termination of the procedural evaluation and the proof that it gives the least fixed point, and therefore that it coincides with declarative semantics. I went fast over this because Anoush will say much more, and it will be done at the level of least fixed point logic on Thursday, right? As a corollary of this, we get that if I give you a data log program, then you can evaluate this semantics in polynomial time. And the reason is we do polynomially many iterations in the size of the database. What we do in every iteration is a query evaluation, a union of conjunctive query evaluation, and this is also in polynomial time, so the whole thing's in polynomial time. Conclusion, the data complexity of data log is in polynomial time. Yes?
do data log query optimized data log query evaluation engines know how to rewrite the first path query that you wrote into the second one in order to optimize the running time in this kind of way? Or
to be honest, I don't know. I hope so, but they have other techniques. They use other techniques. And it's too bad that no one from the logic blocks is here to tell us some of their secrets. I mean, yeah. Now, I will make you believe that although the data complexity of data log is in P, the combined complexity is exponential time complete. So now we see another trade-off. We have gained in expressive power because we can do recursive queries, at least some recursive queries. But while for calculus the combined complexity was in P space, here we hit exponential time, and in fact exponential time complete. So data log has higher combined complexity than relational calculus. Let me show you some interesting data log programs. Non-two-colorability can be expressed in data log. And this uses the fact that the graph is two-colorable if and only if it doesn't contain a cycle of odd length. So what do? We write a program that expresses paths of odd length. That's a variation of the transitive closure. And then we have a rule with no variables that says there exists an x, so there is a path of odd length from x to x. That's the existence of the odd cycle. So we can express non-two-colorability in data log. As a sanity check, can you do this for non-free colorability? Better not, because data log has data complexity in polynomial time. So if you do this, you'll be proving that NP is the same as P. That's not how it's going to happen. But anyway, that's what's going on. Here is my favorite data log program because that's a very nice story behind it. This, in some sense, was proposed by Steve Cook before data log was around. Okay, let me explain. Steve Cook was always thinking in terms of automated deduction and the complexity of automated deduction, and he thought of a simple system where you have a bunch of axioms. This is A, stands for X is an axiom. And you have eternally rule of inference, like modus ponens or resolution. And this says, this is the rule that says X, Y, and Z are related. X follows from Y and Z via resolution. And then the theorems are the axioms or things that follow from already derived theorems via this eternally rule of inference. So Steve Cook in 1974 showed that evaluating this data log program is a problem that's complete for polynomial time under logarithmic space reductions. This was the first problem to be complete for polynomial time. He didn't phrase this way. He presented the computational problem as the path systems, but it's really expressible in data log. So what we see is, in particular, it's unlikely to be in log space unless we have a collapse of polynomial time to log space. So we also see that at the level of data complexity, not only at the level of combined complexity, which is exponential time complete, also at the level of data complexity, data log has higher complexity than relational calculus. What is linear data log? Linear data log is the special case of data log where in every rule there is only one recursive predicate. So that's what linear means. So let's give a linear data log program that computes the binary query cousin from the binary relational schema parent. So how can two people be cousins? Well, we first introduce the notion of a sibling. So two people are siblings if they have a parent in common. And this is what it takes to be first cousin. They have parents who are siblings. And then higher distance cousins, they have parents who are cousins. And you may think this is a toy example, but this is a presidential year election, and 8 years ago we had a presidential election, and people are trying to find out all sorts of connections, and they found out that Barack Obama and Dick Cheney were 8-degree cousins. And you may be interested when you see the link to see what was the reaction of Obama. He said, every family has a black sheep, which goes both ways. So it gets better than that. We have many people from the UK, Sarah Palin and and Princess Diana are 10 degree cousins. So as you see, you really have to run these data log programs, I mean, right? In your ancestry database. That was for your amusement only. You can ask whether every data log program is equivalent to a linear one, and the answer is no. In particular, Cook's this is linearizable, but Cook's program for PAF system is not. I should also say that SQL99 and subsequent versions provide support for linear data log, and this is the syntax with recursive TRs. You write a data log program exactly as you would take these rules and write them in SQL, and then you have a query involving T. So the semantics is that you compute T as the semantics of a data log program. The only restriction is that it has to be linear. Every recursive rule, every rule has only one recursive predicate. And then the result of this becomes a temporary relation on which you can apply some other query, some other projection, selection, Cartesian product, and what you want. So this is the support that currently SQL provides. Yes?
Is there a reason why they're restricted to linear?
Yeah, there's a good reason. I don't think they knew the reason, but basically, linear programs are easier to implement. You can implement them on a stack as opposed to having to do more complicated implementations. I think that's the only reason I can think of, I mean. But I don't know the details. I don't know the details. There is a complexity difference that I suppressed here. The data complexity of linear data log is in the class NC. It's really like transitive closure.
But they're not going to, in the implementation, I did
No. So I don't know people in the standard to ask this question, but it's a good question. Two quick topics. I mentioned that data log goes beyond first order logic because it can do recursive queries. But it's not true that every first order logic query is expressible in data log. And the reason is that first data log cannot express universal quantification. All the queries are monotone. So it's very natural to ask, what is the intersection between data log and relational calculus? And if you know Rosman's preservation theorem under homomorphisms in the finite, you get out of this that it's exactly the union of conjunctive queries. So what this says is that if you have a sentence, a query, which is both expressible in data log and in relational calculus, then actually it's equivalent to a union of conjunctive queries. That's not an obvious result. That requires proof, and it's a corollary to Rosman's theorem.
This was known well before Rosman.
This was before this. And it's coming next. But I wanted to give the Itai Gurevich as a also corollary to Rosman's theorem and Yannakakis Sagiv Yannakakis. But I'm running out of time. I'll suppress this. You can read this. This will be a longer discussion. What I want to close by is telling you what is known about the query equivalence and query containment for data log, because this is a topic of active research. So we saw that as regards the data complexity, the query evaluation problem is in polynomial time, and in fact, polynomial time complete because of Cook's PAF systems problem. And the combined complexity is exponential time complete. This I stated without proof. The membership in exponential time is easy to see. It's the hardness that requires proof. What can we say about the query equivalence problem? Given two data log programs, are they equivalent? Meaning, do they return the same answer on every database instance? This was one of the questions asked in the 80s. And the same thing for the query containment problem. And there was a paper in POTS 1987, I remember this paper, this was the first time I went to the database theory conference, and I felt like a child in a candy store. Here is a logician suddenly understanding one third of the papers in databases because they were about data log. And the query equivalence problem is undecidable, that's Odette Shmueli, 1987. In fact, it is undecidable even for data log queries that come from programs with a single recursive predicate. So keep this in mind, a single binary predicate. And since the query equivalence is undecidable, then the query containment is also undecidable. And the proof is not hard, and it's a very nice proof via reduction from the context-free grammar equivalence problem. Given two context-free grammars, do they define the same language? So in some sense, data log programs are rather close to the production rules of a context-free grammar, and you can use this well-known undecidability of language theory to prove undecidability of equivalence for data log programs. This is not the end of the line, but rather the beginning of a series of investigations trying to find special cases of data log programs for which the containment and equivalence are decidable. In 1988, right after Smueli's paper in Stock, Kosmadakis, Geifman, Kanellakis, and Vardi proved that if you restrict yourself to monadic data log, so monadic exactly in the sense that Anoush was talking today about monadic second order logic, all recursive predicates are unary. Then containment is decidable, and they gave upper and lower bounds for the complexity. It is in doubly exponential time and exponentially time hard. These used rather sophisticated automata theoretic techniques, of which I will say nothing in this course. And it has been open for quite some time to identify fragments of data log that go beyond monadic. And last year in ICDT in Brussels, Reuter, Romero, and Vardi, and Miguel Romero is here, he's sitting in the back, although it's not stated exactly like this, in effect, they prove that the query containment problem for a large fragment of binary data log, and these are regular queries. I hope Miguel will get to give a talk at some point during this program and tell us the details of this. And this is a very nice result. So for regular queries come up in the graph databases and the like, is doubly exponential space complete. So and identifying bigger fragments remains an open problem. So we have results coming now to more recent times. Yes?
So for the fragment in SQL, namely the linear data log, what do you know about containment?
I don't know how to answer the question right away. I have to think. I have to go back and look at, I'm not sure I know. Unary and linear, monadic is different things. Yes, yes. I have to look it up. Thank you. So let me close with this picture. This is basically what we have seen. I have dropped the monotone and the queries with inequalities. But these two columns combined tell us the price we pay by adding recursion to unions of conjunctive queries, right? At the query evaluation problem, from combined complexity, we go from NP complete to exponential time complete. At the data complexity, we go from log space to complete for polynomial time. And as regards equivalence and containment, we are back to the relational calculus situation of undecidability. So in some sense, this is the price of recursion that you pay. So I'll close with this. Thank you very much. Other questions? Answers? Resume at 3 o'clock then.